Hello and welcome to Conversations. Thank you for tuning in. My guest today is Mark Forrest, who is a candidate for County Commissioner in the November election. Welcome to Falmouth and welcome to the program.
Barbara, thanks for having me. It's great to be here.
Right. Now, many of our viewers probably have not much of an idea of the extent of the Cape County government. Mm-hmm. And so perhaps we can start out by talking about what the role of the commissioner is and something about what county government is all about.
No, that's a great question. Thank you. County government on Cape Cod is a very, very unique form of government. Each of the 15 towns here on the Cape are part of Barnstable County. And so we have a Barnstable County government that consists of a budget of $28 million, about 250 employees, and much of the work centers around protecting the Cape's environment and economy. You may be familiar with the Cape Cod Commission. That's a land use regulatory agency. It's a part of county government. We have a well-recognized health and environmental department that does water quality testing and helps protect public health on Cape Cod. We have a cooperative extension service that has an aquaculture program and is involved in Lyme disease and looking at the tick infestation on the Cape. And we have a host of other ancillary services in the area of health and human services and the registry of deeds. So when you add it all up, it's a fairly extensive sort of network of programs and services, many of them designed really to help our towns here on the Cape.
So the services actually that go beyond what a municipality can provide for.
Exactly. Many of the services that we provide at the county level are services that are used by our towns. The biggest, which is, of course, obviously the Cape Cod Commission. They provide land use assistance. They do land use planning. And they're helping the towns on the Cape right now come up with water quality plans to help deal with wastewater and keeping our ponds clean, helping keeping our coastal waterways clean, and helping manage our water supplies and make sure that they're protected.
Well, saying that makes me think that that lingering thought out there that the county government is redundant is probably not true.
Well, it's important to understand that when county government was chartered by the legislature, it gave the county a mission to deal with issues on Cape Cod that go beyond municipal boundaries. All right. And as you know, we're dealing with a lot of problems and challenges that go beyond the responsibility or even the control of any one town. Protecting our waters often involves several towns, particularly our coastal waters and our water supplies. Mm-hmm. The issue of transportation is a regional one. If we're going to help people, you know, deal with traffic or rebuilding our infrastructure, oftentimes the decisions that are being made are regional in nature. For example, traffic over the bridges. We all know that that's an issue for Bourne,
right.
It's an issue for Falmouth, and an issue for the islands. Mm-hmm. So we all are concerned about the health of the Sagamore Bridge, the Bourne Bridge, and how traffic is managed over the bridges. Housing, affordable housing, homelessness, economic development, right? When you add up, when you look at the Cape, there's so many challenges that we're wrestling that need to be addressed at a regional level.
Yep, that's true. Well, those responsibilities that a commissioner has are enormous. What is your background for being able to handle these issues?
I have an interesting background. I started off working in local government. I have a master's degree in public administration, and my career track has always been municipal government. And I started my career initially in Harwich, working for the Board of Selectmen, while I was working on my graduate degree. Mm-hmm. But then my first real job was in Provincetown, in the town manager's office there. I worked there for 5 years. I eventually became town manager. I was one of the youngest town managers in the mm-hmm. Commonwealth. And my job initially was to work on a fiscal crisis. The town of Provincetown was having some challenges balancing the budget. And part of my job was to be part of a new management team that would come in there and help find ways to operate government more efficiently, find ways to better manage our revenues, do a better job at balancing the books, and to come up with new revenue sources. And so it was in Provincetown that I really developed this knack for finding state and federal money to help support local government and local programs, and to really, really protect taxpayers from having to pay, you know, added costs for government services. So one of the things that I worked on was getting funds for helping rebuild the town's water system. I later on helped the town get funds for a sewer system. I helped rebuild the town's waterfront, the redevelopment of McMillan Wharf, which in Provincetown was at the heart of the town's fishing industry and whale watch industry. These were incredibly expensive projects, and so I developed a knack for figuring out ways to get funds for those projects from the state government and federal government, since obviously we pay taxes too, and those are our dollars.
Right.
So it's important to bring some of our tax dollars back here. And then I worked on a fascinating challenge in Provincetown where we had groundwater contamination in a neighboring town of Truro, which is where Provincetown gets its water. In many of our communities, our water comes from sometimes the neighboring town.
Yes, yes.
So as a manager in Provincetown, we had a groundwater contamination issue in Truro. This contamination was threatening our local water supplies in Truro, and so we had to figure out a way to deal with that. That cost a lot of money. Took a lot of time, a lot of work, and we were able to get grant money, outside sources of funding for that.
Gosh, you certainly have had lots of experience at what we call the granular level, which is important because then you, when you're working on policy, you have been there and you've seen that. And
right. Well, it helped me in Provincetown. That's where I got to know the congressmen and the delegation, our senators. I did a lot of work with our senators and congressmen. Congressman Gary Studs eventually asked me to join his staff so that I could help other communities on the Cape. And then Congressman Delahunt did the same thing. He asked me to join his staff so I could help other communities. But while I was in Provincetown, I worked with a number of communities on the Cape. I worked in county government. I also helped create a community development corporation that could work with towns on affordable housing and economic development. And so we set up this group called the Community Development Partnership, which exists today. It works in each of the communities on the Lower Cape and helps them in create new affordable housing rehabilitation for homeowners that may find their home in disrepair. They may need a new septic system. They may need weatherization. They may need some energy efficiency. So we got that organization up and running. So I'm very proud of that and that group.
What do you see are the issues facing county government now, the most important ones that a commissioner you will be facing?
Well, we have a lot on our plate. Let me just also mention, if you don't mind, right now I teach American government at the community college.
Yeah.
We were talking about this before we came on screen or online. I love teaching American government. I'm very excited about bringing kids into public service and understanding how government works, and that's a lot of fun for me. I also advise mayors and other governments on how to get major economic development projects off the ground. So that's kind of what I'm doing now. But I think it all suits me and helps prepare me for this office that I seek, county commissioner, because many of the challenges that we're dealing with in the Cape are challenges that I've had a lot of experience working on and dealing with both in my current work but also in my years working in local government and with our congressmen. I think the big challenges going forward, there are many of them. I would say clean water. I would say housing, affordable housing. There's this term that's getting used a lot, which is referred to as the senior tsunami, and that is this growing elderly population. As baby boomers like me retire, and we're going to need a different set of services, and there'll be different needs. We have seniors getting, more and more seniors with sight loss issues and vision impairments, so they'll be looking.
Transportation, yes, I can see that even now, being able to find a way to get to a doctor's appointment, to shop.
Exactly.
It's transportation.
Exactly, so I've been meeting with officials at the Regional Transit Authority about how we can sort of expand services for seniors, for retirees in the area of transportation. We're going to have to do more in the area of congregate housing, elderly housing. As people look to get out of their homes, they're looking for other options in terms of where they can live, whether it's dealing with some kind of congregate site or retirement living. My in-laws lived at a place in Yarmouth called Thurwood Place.
Yes.
It was a wonderful retirement area, and eventually as they became disabled, they had people there to care for them. It's getting very expensive these days, so we need to find more options on the housing side for our seniors, for our elderly, so that they can, you know, live out their lives in a very good quality of life. So there's that. We have transportation issues. We've got two aging bridges. We got to figure out how we sort of replace those and how that gets done, and do that in a way that doesn't burden the taxpayers on the Cape. You know, I could go on, but I think those are some of the major issues that we're going to need to wrestle with today.
And they're regional concerns.
They are. They're very much so regional issues. I think we've got some great talent in county government, people that can help us address them. But part of the job of a county commissioner is also to make sure that these issues that we're wrestling with here stay on the front burner in Boston and in Washington.
Right.
Oftentimes, if they don't hear from us often enough, these things tend to take a back seat. And like I said, given all the tax dollars that we send to Beacon Hill, given all the tax dollars that people here on the Cape send to Washington, it's incredibly important that our issues become a priority, that they don't lose track of what's important here at home.
You've had a lot of experience, too, in fundraising and knowing where the sources of funding are, and that will certainly be very important.
Yeah, no, I'm glad you raised that. One of the things that I worked on that I'm very proud of is the work that I did here in the Upper Cape and in Falmouth and in Mashpee, Bourne, and in Sandwich, and that is dealing with the groundwater contamination problems out at the military base. Back in the early 80s, I was asked to come to a meeting here in Falmouth, and I learned firsthand as to how the groundwater contamination problems from the base were creating real problems here in Falmouth. One of the well fields had to get shut down. The town had to find another water supply. And sure enough, in Mashpee, the same thing was happening. And then eventually Bourne and Sandwich were hit with contamination problems. So this was pollution migrating from the base, coming into the surrounding communities. And we had to figure out how to tackle this problem. We obviously got the Pentagon involved, but even they were sort of wrestling with it as well. They were having a challenge. So we had to sort of put in place a very good cleanup team, a good cleanup program. And then the big thing is finding out where's the money to take care of it. So far, we've been able to get the Pentagon and others in the federal government to put close to $700 million right here on Cape Cod dealing with this groundwater contamination. And when we first found out about it, there was no program to deal with it. So we had to help create a program to deal with it. So some of this involves finding the problem, identifying it, building consensus, and then being aggressive in getting the state and federal resources needed to tackle it. That's what we're going to have to do with clean water. If we're going to protect our coastal waters and keep them healthy, to keep our estuaries and our embayments healthy, they're nurseries for all sorts of fisheries and wildlife. So if we're going to keep our estuaries healthy, if we're going to keep our ponds healthy, if we're going to protect our water supplies, we need to find new and creative ways to deal with these threats, but also the financial resources to tackle them.
That's right.
Also get the federal and state government a little bit more involved in helping us deal with this stuff. So
that puts you in a position to understand and find a solution for the problem with the fire academy. Your background and your experience has allowed you to understand exactly what's going on.
Yeah, what's unfortunate is that out at the, for the people watching this show, it's important to understand there's a fire training academy that provides training to all the fire departments on the Cape. And what that does is that saves each of the towns money in terms of training their firefighters.
Right.
Because to be good at firefighting, you need to have regular training.
Right.
And it's much more affordable to do it here on Cape Cod than to send firefighters to Stowe or other places to get that kind of training.
And there are always advances in technology and in technique and method so that a firefighter needs to constantly learn new techniques.
That's exactly it. We've had an academy here that most firefighters have had experience training there. But some of the chemicals that were used in the foams and in some of the other fire training activities, some of the chemicals we've come to find out can cause some contamination and create some problems. So we do have some chemical contamination in the ground there, and we need to take care of it. So The county is working with the town of Barnstable to make sure that there's adequate remediation game plan in place. The county is going to have to come up with some additional money to help pay for some of the remediation of that. And then what we need to do is we also need to learn the lessons from this. And the fact of the matter is, one of the lessons that we're learning is that we have these new emerging contaminants. So the things that are in the ground today, we thought 10 years ago, they wouldn't create a problem.
But yes, who knew?
Exactly. So some of these contaminants, they're called emerging contaminants or contaminants of emerging concern. We're starting to realize that some of these things we're going to have to deal with now. We're finding these chemicals in other parts of the Cape. We're finding them on the Upper Cape, elsewhere in the Mid Cape, and on the Lower Cape. So not only do we have to to remediate what's occurring at the Fire Training Academy, we need to also investigate just where these contaminants might be elsewhere on Cape Cod, and then work with our towns to figure out how we tackle them in the months ahead.
So it's really interesting that you not only enjoy teaching about government, you are a doer. You are very much part of the practice.
Well, I like making government work,
Yes.
And I think what we realize is that these institutions need to be shaped and need to be managed and utilized in ways that best suit the needs of the people. And oftentimes, the needs or the problems change. Circumstances change, and so government needs to adapt to the changing circumstances. I can get just as frustrated with bureaucracy as anybody, and it's incredibly important that rather than we run from these problems, we try to tackle them and work together and do them in a way that's efficient, that saves the taxpayer money, you know?
Yes, I suppose that working to make bureaucracy flexible means that the individuals who have their offices and play a role need to really work, make it a point to work well with each other.
Yeah, government today, one of the things that I think we're learning is that there's no one level of government that can solve all our problems, that each government has a role, and that it needs to be nimble, it needs to be efficient. People need to adapt and change and learn how to work together and draw from each other's strengths. And that where we find efficiencies, we need to pursue them and seek them and then use those resources to deal with maybe other new issues or problems. I'm a big believer in balanced governments and financial efficiency. Think about this for just a moment. When you add up all of the budgets on Cape Cod in each town for local government, schools, fire and water and everything else, and you look at the population of Cape Cod, it's only 210,000 people. So for a population of 210,000 people, we're spending between $1.2 and $1.5 billion, that's billion with the B, dollars providing local government services to that population. All right. Now the county government is only $28 million. It's got a budget the size of Truro's. But what it does is it brings in grant monies and other dollars and other resources to try to keep the cost of government down and to find efficiencies, ways we can collaborate so that we can deliver services in a much more efficient way. And if you're spending $1.2 billion or between $1.2 and $1.5 billion to provide government services to local communities, that's almost twice as much as what is needed to provide those kinds of services to other communities with the same population.
Right.
So there's significant room in this equation here to save money. And that's what we got to do. We got to find ways we can work with towns to save money because a lot of our taxpayers are living on fixed incomes.
Right.
And their ability to pay for more government is very, very limited. So we need to be, and we should be, very aggressive and finding ways to save money, to collaborate, to regionalize.
Right.
And
to not duplicate.
Exactly. No, each of the 15 towns, if each one just keeps doing the same thing, it's very inefficient. So we need to find ways to collaborate. So that's going to be a priority of mine. I worked on that when I was in local government. I think there's some opportunities here.
Good. That makes a lot of sense. And so now your home is in Harwich.
No, actually, my home is in Yarmouth.
Oh, in
I spent
Yarmouth.
My early years in Harwich. Harwich is a beautiful community.
Yes.
But my family, I raised my kids in Yarmouth. They went through the public school systems there. It's a great town.
Mm-hmm. And when you worked in Washington, it was with Gary Studs. Many of us remember him as being very effective.
Congressman Studs was probably one of the most prolific and most productive legislators that ever served in the Congress. He served in a bipartisan way. Mm-hmm. He served with Republicans and Democrats working together to get things done. He was very involved in funding and programming at the Maritime Academy. My role in his office was to not only work on a lot of the Cape issues, work with the fishing industry, mm-hmm. to work on water issues, housing, and economic development, but was also to train a constituent services staff to serve people. So when you as a resident here on the Cape called the congressional office looking for help, whether mm-hmm. it's to solve a problem with the VA or to solve a problem with the post office, any arm of the federal government where the red tape was mm-hmm. driving you nuts, we had staff there that could help solve that problem for you. So my job was to train and supervise this staff so they could be there on call for you and other constituents, other people living here, to help solve problems involving the federal government. So part of my work was to train people to solve almost any kind of issue involving almost any arm of the federal government.
That experience is certainly going to be useful for you. That experience, the lessons that you learned, the successes and the problems, will you be able to apply to what is happening today?
Yeah, I mean, what I want to be able to do is apply what I've learned, my skill set, right. my background right. to the helping solve some of the mm-hmm. Cape's most pressing challenges. I've enjoyed working on the Cape and working on these issues. I've often found that the further away you go, whether it's to Beacon Hill or Washington, it's very easy to lose touch. I'm yeah. very much more at home mm-hmm. here being on the Cape, working on these issues, working with our local selectmen right. and local officials. You know, I don't think people realize just how important local government is or regional government is. It's where things hit, you know, where the rubber hits the road, you know?
Yeah, definitely. And the problems are certainly real there. I don't know how much basis there is in the thought that you mentioned the contamination, that some of the high incidence of cancer on the Cape may be related to contamination.
Well, in some of our communities, we do see statistically some elevated rates of cancer for certain cancers. While we may not know the causes, we may not know what's happening, I think one of the things it does is it reminds us of just how important
yes,
it is
yes.
to protect this environment.
Right.
So we've all heard the adage, you know, the environment is the economy on the Cape. Well, the environment is also our health as well.
Oh, yes, yes. It's often said that we need to work on the environment because it's a service economy. We need our tourists, but you're right. We need health,
exactly.
safety, and
right.
for our health.
Well, one of the things that's important to note is that in some communities where the environment has become degraded, where the water quality has become poor, it affects tourism but also retirement living. These become communities that people don't want to retire in. These not only are places where people don't want to vacation in, but they don't want to retire there. So our environment is critical for almost every aspect of our economy, not just to mention public health, but also these other areas as well that are important. You know, there are areas where I think some of these problems we can utilize, I believe, as opportunities as well to do some interesting things. For example, clean water. The Cape, I believe, can be a place where we find and develop new technologies to solve our problems,
mm-hmm.
that we come up with new and innovative ideas to remediate contamination. And we can use these technologies to maybe incubate and start new businesses.
Well,
into new economic
yeah.
opportunities.
And some of that is ongoing. I think that the county government has a research center where certainly methods of removing nitrogen from water is being tested.
Exactly. Out at the military
yeah.
base, we have what is called the Alternative Septic System Test
yeah.
Center. And that was a project that I worked on getting established.
Oh,
I worked
really?
On getting the funding
ah.
and getting it approved by the federal government. It's being run by the county, George Hoyfelder,
yes.
the county health director.
Mm-hmm.
He's done a remarkable job in managing this center. And this center is going to help us identify new and innovative septic system technologies. Part of their job is...
That will be huge.
It will be incredibly important. That's a county function. Mm. I'd like to see us get some partnerships with other universities and other corporations that are developing some other very interesting technologies. But there's no reason why Cape Cod can't be a center of technology for new clean water technologies, new marine technologies. As we know, there are new technologies coming out of the Oceanographic Institution and the MBL all the time. So we need to figure out ways to harness even clean water technologies. There are a number of new companies that have established themselves up in the Boston area. So I honestly think Cape Cod can be a place where we can develop new and exciting technologies and economic opportunities and jobs in some of these areas.
That's very encouraging. The technology is helping us to identify contaminants, but technology will help us certainly find ways to remove them.
Exactly. In fact, with the cleanup out at the base, with the cleanup out there, we've actually have identified some promising technologies that have not been critical for cleaning up some of the chlorinated solvents and some of those chemicals. But some of these technologies actually have applications in cleaning up nutrients that we find in our wastewater. Mm. All right? So now the challenge is let's test those and evaluate those, maybe modify them in a certain way so that we can optimize their performance in dealing with nitrogen. So I think we're living in a very unique and interesting time as well. It's not only just challenging, and there are things that we haven't talked about, other challenges like sea level rise and climate change and a host of other things. But just dealing with the pollution issues, there are opportunities here to develop some new and exciting technologies, maybe create some jobs here on Cape Cod, some new businesses that can help us prosper as a region.
It seems to me that given your background, you've seen an awful lot of problems, but you seem optimistic about the future.
Yeah, you know, I'm very optimistic about the future. As a teacher, I see the kids coming in, and I'm so excited about what they bring to the college and what they offer in terms of skills and talent. I see our leadership here in the Cape. We've got some great selectmen here in this community and around the Cape. So between the political leadership and the kids and the energy that's here in the Cape, I think we have a lot to look forward to.
Let's take a moment to remind viewers that an election is coming up.
Yes.
And coming up rapidly, November?
November 8th, there's an election. I'll be on the ballot for county commissioner.
Yes.
And I would very much appreciate your support, in this election.
Great. That's going to be the ballot for everyone.
Exactly. This will be the big, from president on down. Oftentimes people forget those races at the bottom end of the ticket.
That's right.
So you'll see my name on the ballot, but it'll be at the bottom end. So I hope people don't forget about me.
And we want to encourage our viewers to be sure to vote. It's very important that you vote. We're rather disappointed at some of the low turnout. So people need to realize that their livelihood very often depends upon the choices they make at the ballot. So I want to thank you very much for being with us and for giving us this explanation of county government
and
about your candidacy. So thank you very much for being with us.
Thank you. It's been great.
Yes. And thank you very much for joining us. And do tune in next time when we have conversations with Barbara. Thank you.
That was great.